Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And every heart proclaim the mercy of your name on earth as it is in heaven.
The kingdom is yours,
for the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever,
let your kingdom
amen.
Come. So let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let every heart proclaim mercy of your name on earth as it is in heaven. So let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let every heart proclaim mercy of your name on earth as it is
for the kingdom.
For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours. And the glory forever. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory.
Come on, just the voices.
For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours,
and the glory forever and ever.
For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever and ever.
Let's keep singing that.
For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever and ever. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever.
We surrender it all to you, Lord. It all belongs to you, O God. Your word says that you returned to what was yours, but we did not recognize you. But not here, Father, not today, Lord. We not only recognize you, but we invite you, Holy Spirit, that your will be done in this place today, Father. We thank you for the breath of life that you've given us, Lord. For the kingdom, the power, the glory, Father. It's all unto you, Father. Oh, we bless you, Lord.
For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory is yours forever. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory. Power is yours, and the glory forever.
Keep singing out to him, church. Let him know how welcomed he is in this place. I know he already knows, but let's voice it out. Let our tongues bless him this afternoon. Let our hearts, our minds, and our souls be aligned to his will. That we would be conformed to his will. That we would be transformed by his Spirit. We love you, Lord. You are worthy. like you, Jesus. None like you, Jesus. The kingdom, the power, the glory. It's yours forever, Lord. Forever and ever and ever, Lord. We just bless your holy name. Just wanna bless you, Lord. Just wanna bless you, Lord. Come on, church. Let's call out to him. A little more worship. A little more praise. Let me hear your praise unto the heavens. Come on. If you got nothing to say, sing hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah unto you, O God. Let your glory fall. Let it fall in this place, O Lord. Let it come down. Worthy are you, O God.
Let us go as one church into his presence. Let's get into the car of Jesus and drive around heaven for a little bit. Let us jump into the river of life, because that's what it is. It is life. And when we realize that we can be in heaven, we are in heaven. I'm not going to say we can be, because we are. We are in heaven, because his word says that we are seated in heavenly places. So it is what it is. Jump into the river of life. Whatever it is that you need, and that is in line with God's word, then it is life. So jump into a river of joy. Jump into a river of hope. Jump into a river of peace.
Yes, Lord.
Jump into a river of love. But Father, let us make these declarations and jump into your arms, Father.
I see heaven invading this place, and I see angels praising your holy name, and I sing praises, I sing praises, I give you honor, worthy Jesus. I see glory falling in this place, and I see hope restored, free healing of all diseases, and I sing praises, and I sing praises, I give you honor, worthy Jesus. And we give you praise. And all of the honor, you are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise and all of the glory, God. We give you praise and all of the honor, you are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise and all of the glory.
We give you praise.
And we give you praise. and all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise and all of the glory, God, and all of the glory.
Let your presence
fill this place. Let heaven come. Let your angels be released. Let heaven come. We will worship at your feet. Let heaven face to face, we wanna meet. Let heaven come. We give you praise and all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God. And we give you praise, all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God.
I see heaven,
and I see heaven invading this place. I see angels praising your holy name. And I sing praises, I give you honor, worthy Jesus. And I see glory falling in this place. The healing of all diseases. And I sing praises, and I sing praises. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. And we give you praise and all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise and all of the glory. Give you praise and all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise and all of the glory, God, and all of the glory. And all of
your presence.
Let your presence fill this place. Let heaven come. Let your angels be released. Let heaven come. We will worship at your feet. Let heaven face to face, we want to meet. Let heaven come. And we give you praise and all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise and all of the glory, God. We give
the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God.
Can't you see that it's good?
take another step till the water's to your knees. Take another step to your waist. You're halfway there. The Lord says, let's go for a swim. Are you ready to jump in? Jump in with all your heart. Jump in with all your soul. Give praise to the Lord. Give praise. Holy, 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 holy
I looked again, I heard a company of angels around the throne, the animals and the elders, 10,000 times 10,000, their number, thousands after thousands after thousands, in full song, the slain lamb is worthy.
Hallelujah.
Take power, the wealth, the wisdom, the strength, take honor, the glory, the blessing. Then I heard every creature in heaven and earth, in underworld and sea, joining all voices in all places, singing to the one on the throne, to the Lamb, the blessing, the honor, the glory, the strength forever and ever.
Hallelujah. Come on, somebody just give the Lord a praise offering. Come on. Hallelujah. Oh, you're worthy, 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 oh Lord. Well, I got good news for you. I've got a word from heaven today. And then we're going to get back into heaven's presence at the altar call today, is what the Lord told me. So let's get out of our chairs right now and let's just welcome everybody. Let's just love on somebody right now. Just go out there and tell them how happy you are that they're here today. Hallelujah.
About it in the back. She knows about it.
So while you guys are getting your tithes and offerings ready, I'm going to make a few announcements. So it's been brought to our attention that we need a new printer in the church office. So, and also the upcoming bills is you partners, we had a meeting last week, I think, or a week or two ago, about the CPS and water bill that are going to be added to the rent now, or part of the rent, I should say. So it's really important, guys. Don't be afraid to tithe. Trust in the Lord. He will provide. I'm going to give you a scripture, Luke 6:38, and it says, the amount that you give will determine the amount you get back. Trust him. Trust him, that's all I can say. He will give you all that you need. You will not lack when you trust in the Lord. So because these CPS and water bills are coming, I'm trusting you guys to trust the Lord that everything will be provided. Offerings, your tithings, everything. Everything will help, and it's all for the church. Okay, we need to really be unified right now with everything going on, and we really appreciate you guys. And we're looking to get a cabinet. Pastor Irene is constantly on the fellowship, bringing things back and forth, and they're heavy things. So we're trying to get a cabinet for to keep it in the church fellowship hall. That way, anything, any supplies that we have is going to be kept there. It'll be easier for everyone. And I'm bringing up. The river baptisms are this Saturday. It's going to be at Guadalupe State Park. I need to bring up that my sister brought to my attention there's a cost to get into the park, and we were not aware of that. It's $7 for 13 and older. So any kids under 12 will be free, but it's $7 per person. And Jonathan and I were going to look at the map online and see where we can try to pinpoint maybe a meeting place. And Sister Elizabeth told us that their lot number, there's numbers everywhere. I think you said number 30, right? So we're going to try to see who can get there early, which one of us. And maybe we'll meet there, but we'll be announcing it on Facebook and texting you guys, letting you know where we're going to meet. It starts at 12. Okay, and the baptisms will actually start at 1, but we'll be there at 12 o'clock for sure. So we hope all of you guys can make it.
All right. God bless everybody. Amen. I thought this thing was not working right, but my wife just talks a little low. So we're going to go ahead and just anybody that's a first time visitor, please stand up. Nobody? Anybody? All right. We got one visitor in the back. We welcome you and we are happy to see you today. God bless you. We're going to have a fellowship. So for the first-time visitors, our pastor just wants a word with you guys on the way out. Don't worry. He's nice. And then also, we do a fellowship. We're going to do a fellowship today, so any first-time visitors, we would like to have you as a guest with pastor, just to kind of get to know the pastor. So it's perfect day for you to show up today. Amen. All right. So we're going to do the tithes and offerings. Everyone ready? I'm ready. Okay, let's all stand up together. As we receive today's offering, we are believing the Lord for jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefit sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, debts paid off, expenses decrease, blessing and increase. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of my financial needs, that I may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus! All right, let's come up and give our tithes and offerings to the Lord and the building fund, whatever you have to give today.
hallelujah. Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Now, I'll tell you now, if you're a Bible flipper, you're probably going to want to take me down just a little bit. If you're a Bible flipper, you're probably going to want to write down the scriptures, because I've got a whole bunch of scriptures for you today. Okay? Some will be on top. Some of them I'm going to fly right through. Okay? So don't get mad at Jeremiah if you don't see it up there. I'm just warning you ahead of time. I've got a lot of scripture for you today, because how many of you know that when God repeats himself, it's usually for a reason?
Yep.
In fact, he says, verily, verily, I say unto you. And then he says, where two or more witnesses that say the same thing. There's a reason he's doing it. And I've got a whole lot more than two or three, because I've got to talk to you today about an issue that I feel that is hurting the church, even this church and the American church. And I've got to talk to you today about these things. But one of the things I want to tell you is that God is still speaking today. Somebody say he's speaking. And one of the things that he's been speaking about, that recently we've been talking with the pastors and we've been praying about it, and God kind of finalized it for me this week, was core values. Somebody say core values.
Core values.
Now, what is a core value? It is a value which is at the core of everything you do. Does that make sense? It's a value that is at the core of everything you do. And God gave us three core values. Now, we may mature. I hope we mature as a church as we grow and become older and mature in the Lord. But there's three that he gave us, and he gave it to me. He kind of rearranged them for me, and he called it EPA. Now, I all know that Environmental Protection Agency is what you think of with EPA. But that's how I know it was the Lord, because it was easy to remember. EPA. And these three core values I'm going to talk to you just about a little bit, because I want you to understand where we're going. EPA, E stands for empower. P stands for pursue. And A stands for what? Advance. Okay? Now, what do I mean? On empower, E, it's empowering you, God's people. Somebody say empowering me.
Empowering
you, God's people, through God's word, equipping you to walk fully in your callings. That's what it is to empower. It's not to empower by handing out titles. It's to empower by handing out your true calling, which is beyond titles. Titles are just your responsibility. If you're an usher, your responsibility is to usher people to their seats. If you're a pastor, your responsibility is to pastor. Your identity is not in what you do. That's what the world teaches. Okay? Your identity is in who you belong to.
Amen.
That's Christ Jesus. And that's what God teaches. Somebody say, God teaches me that. So the first one is empower. And the scripture there is Hebrews 4:12, which is the scripture of the church. For the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and of the marrow. He is a discerner of thoughts and intents of the heart. We want to empower you through God's word, that you would know that the Holy Spirit would come. And he doesn't just divide your soul and your spirit, but he divides the joints and the marrow. Come on. In other words, he doesn't just handle the spiritual things, which so many people in the church are so caught up with, and then they go out in the flesh and think God has nothing to do with the flesh. Come on. But he in the joints and the marrow means he wants to be involved in your body. Physical body, as well as your spirit and your soul. Come on. The second core value is to pursue. It's based on Matthew 6:33, and it is to pursue Father's presence and kingdom. It needs to be central in everything, because today, church, in the American church, so many churches are pursuing what the flesh desires, what the people desire, in order to grow a bigger church. But here at Living Word Church, we're going to pursue what Father desires.
Amen.
Okay? And that's Matthew 6:33, because it says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. When Father grows the church, Father grows the church. When Father speaks, we listen. Okay? And we've got to, as a core, as people of God, and as biblical standard, we need to pursue, or we need to pursue his presence. Somebody say, I want to go after him. Now, A stands for advance, okay? That we carry and usher the kingdom of heaven everywhere we go. Now, we've been talking about carrying the presence for almost a year now. And I still don't think we're done. But in order to advance the kingdom, that means we have to take the kingdom wherever we go. How many of you know that when an army advances, they're taking the land that they've just advanced over? But if you're not taking the flag, the standard, the one whom you represent wherever you go, I'm talking Walmart, I'm talking HEB, I'm talking to your family's homes, then you're not advancing the kingdom. Come on. If you go out to work and you forget about your Christianity because you're at work and nobody would understand, you're not advancing the kingdom. You're blending in with somebody else's kingdom, church. Are you hearing me today? Advance is based on Matthew 28, 18 through 20. It says, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power, somebody say all, is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore, teach all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. So yeah, somebody say, thank you, Lord. So Living Word Church is going to have these three core values to empower, to pursue, and advance. And these three core values will be a part of the worship team. It'll be a part of every ministry that is in this house. Literally, and as I've talked to Andrew Peters and some other pastors, literally, if the core values are not presented when a new ministry wants to create something within the house, you send them back to the drawing board until that ministry is willing to meet the core values of the house. Because otherwise, you have a body with many heads, which we all know is a freak of nature. Amen. So I want to talk to you today. If we don't empower, if we don't pursue, if we don't advance, what are we really doing? Are we just having church services? Come on. Now, can I be real with you today? Okay, some of you, okay. All right, good. It seems to me that there's a perceived problem here at Living Word Church. Notice I said perceived. And the perception of that problem is that we're always under attack. I want to talk to you about that today. How many of you are under attack right now? You're going through something. Okay, good. You notice I said good. Praise the Lord. Somebody say, praise the Lord, I'm under attack. I know you're like, he's crazy. No, I'm not. I'm scriptural, and I'm going to show you. There seems to be a continual attack at the church, a continual attack of the church's partners. And I've had people actually leave the church because of it. They say, when I'm at your church, I feel the presence of God more than I ever felt it anywhere else. But I'm also under attack all the time, so I'm going to go to that church. Because I'm not under attack there, and the music is nice, and the preaching is nice. But I'm not under, these are literal words that I've been given, and this is not just one couple or one people. People have told me here, they say, you know what, Pastor, we're not leaving, but it just seems like we're under so much attack while we're here at Living Word. And we didn't get that attack when we were somewhere else. It's like the preaching's good and the ministry is good and the worship is good, but we just weren't attacked like this at other places. And it seems to me there is a perception that Living Word Church is always under attack and there's something wrong with it. But I have to ask you a question, church. What happened to the believers in the Bible? What happened when they shared the gospel? Did everyone have fun and have fellowship Sunday, every Sunday? That's not what happened, was it? Well, Acts chapter 5, they got it in the back. Acts 5, 41 and 42. This is, you think I'm crazy. Let me show you how crazy they were. It says, they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. And daily in the temple and in every house, they ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. Beloved, according to Scripture, if you're not being persecuted, if you're not being attacked, if you're not suffering shame, you're not doing something right. I know that's not a popular sermon, but this is the life of the Christian that we in the world we live in. But you notice something, beloved. For everything I've gone through, God has never failed me. Come on. Amen. For everything I've gone through, I've always wound up on top somehow. But somehow I get tired of going through it, and I don't find it joyful when I'm shamed for the gospel. I don't find it joyful when somebody persecutes me for the gospel's sake. I'm not joyful in it because I'm tired of going through the problem. Come on. I'm tired of going through the problems all the time. And what happens is there's a word right now, there's this grace right now that everyone's talking about that seems to mean that, you know what, you don't have to go through that. But let me tell you something. I may weep all through the night, but joy comes in the morning. I want to give you a lot of scripture right now because this is hard for you to swallow. You're telling me I've got to be persecuted? Yes. You're telling me I have to go through shame? Yes. You live in a world that you're in it but not of it, church. That's not my word, that's His word. Hallelujah. We've got to get past this poor old me. Poor, look at what I'm going through. You don't know half the things that me and my wife go through. And we carry your burden as well. But why are we still standing here? Why are we still doing what we do? Because we understand that if you're not persecuted, if you're not attacked, if you're not ashamed for the gospel's sake, then you're doing something wrong. Let me give you a bunch of scriptures if you're ready to write. Psalm 9:13 says, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, consider my trouble which I suffer of them that hate me, you that lift me up from the gates of death." Psalm 119:86 says, "All your commandments are faithful, they persecute me wrongly." Jeremiah 20:11 says, "But the Lord is with me as a mighty, terrible one. Therefore, my persecutors, they shall stumble. They shall not prevail. They shall be greatly ashamed, for they shall not prosper. Their everlasting confusion shall never be forgotten." Yes. Matthew 5:12 says, "Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you." John 15:18 says, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it ever hated you." John 15:20 says, "Remember the word that I said to you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also." Romans 8:35 says, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword?" No, none of these. 1 Corinthians 4:12 says, "And labor, working with our own hands, being reviled, we bless; being persecuted, we suffer it." 2 Corinthians 12:10 says, "Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities. I take pleasure in persecutions and in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then he is strong." 1 Thessalonians 3:4 says, "For truly, when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass, and you know." 2 Timothy 3:12 says, "Yes, and all," listen to what it's about to say, "and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." If you're living godly in Christ Jesus, you will suffer persecution. That's the word of God. That's not what these preachers are preaching to make you feel good. That's the word of God. Hebrews 10:33 says, "Partly, while you were made a spectacle both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly while you became companions of them that were so used to it," meaning you were actually with those that were being punished. 1 Peter 4:12 says, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you." 1 Peter 4:16 says, "Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on his behalf." I'm sorry, it's not mentioned in the Bible how your life is going to be a bed of roses, or you're going to walk just in the oil and the butter all your life. That's not listed in the Bible, as much as there will be persecutions, there will be afflictions, there will be attacks. And the truth is, beloved, you know people that they don't seem to be being attacked. Come on. My question is, are they living a godly life? Are we looking at their lives and looking at all the things that they have that we don't have? Or maybe should we be looking at whether or not they're living a godly life? Because when you live a godly life, you will get the attention of hell. Come on. When it comes to EPA core values, and now I'm going to preach to you. When it comes to our EPA or our core values, I think we've got the empowering down because we share lots of scripture and our church knows lots of scripture. I think we got the pursuing down because you guys get up here and you worship the Lord and you get on your face, but I don't think we have the advancing down. Now don't run out the back door. I think many of us have become tired. I've been tired. I think many of us have lost focus of what we're supposed to be in Christ and what we're actually going to go through in Christ. I think many of us need to remember the word that says to grab hold of the plow and not look back. Worship team, would you come on up here, please? While they're coming up here, every time you get tired, I want you to remember this, Hebrews 12:3. Say it with me, Hebrews 12:3. Say it again, Hebrews 12:3. Put it on in the back. Hebrews 12:3. It says, "For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds." You want to know why you get wearied? You want to know why you give up in Christ? You want to know why so many have left the church? It's because they don't consider what Jesus did for him or us. We don't consider that. We sit there and say, "But God, you don't know what I'm going through." Yes, he does. He knew you were going to go through it before you were knit in your mother's womb. "But God, you never went through this." Really? You say, "Well, you know what? I've lost this or I've lost that." Really? He gave up everything for you and me. See, Hebrews 12:3 says, consider him. When you're tired, when you're weary, when you say, "I can't go on," consider him. He could have said, "You know what, God, you know what? I just can't do this, man. Have you seen the way they treat me? Have you seen the way they act? I am the Son of God." Some of you sit there and say, "I'm a son or daughter of God. I'm not supposed to be treated like this." Yet the Son of God was treated. He was spitting in his face. They pulled out his beard. They covered his head and beat on him, and then they said, "Prophesy, who hit you?" He could have told them their mother, their father, their grandparents, their great-grandparents. He could have told them what they ate for lunch that day. He didn't. Hebrews 12:3 says, every time you're tired, every time you want to give up, consider him. Every time you want to just say, "You know what, enough is enough," consider him. Jesus himself suffered. And you know what? I've heard this. So many say Jesus suffered so you don't have to. That is true in the light of eternity, because you're suffering. You've been saved from suffering in the next life, because instead of the pit of hell, you get to step into heaven. Come on. But never, ever in the Bible does it say that you won't suffer while you're in this world. Show me the scripture and I'll walk off this pulpit. You cannot find that scripture because it does not exist. You cannot find a scripture that says you can live your life however you want out there and just come into church and do what you're going to do in church here. You can't find that scripture. It does not exist. I call that the book of delusions. Because we're making those up, those scriptures, and we put them in there. God has called you. Somebody say, He's called me.
He's called me.
He's called you. And He has not called you to live a life of just pure joy as the world perceives it. His joy is when you find yourself worthy of being persecuted for His name's sake. Because that means you're doing something right. How many of you want to do something right for a change? See, we can't advance the kingdom until we learn how to advance His kingdom. If what you do is you come into church and you get your fill up and you get your little, you get your, you know, your batteries recharged, and then you go back out and you live your life for yourself, or you live your life like the world lives it, and they can't tell the difference between you and them, what happens is, beloved, you're coming in and you're just kind of getting a recharge and you're trying to exist, you're trying to just kind of go on. But God says, I want you to live life and live life abundantly. But it's not by living your life. It's not by your plans. It's not by your purposes. It's by His plans. It's by His purposes. And when you come to that understanding, then you know that even like I said earlier, if there is weeping all night long, joy always comes in the morning.
Amen.
Because His grace is renewed every morning. That's how I can have peace that surpasses all understanding, because the world doesn't have peace that surpasses all. Just look at what's going on in the world right now. Your Bible does not say there's no suffering in life. On contrary, it says the opposite. That is why I say, if life does not have the world coming against it, make sure you haven't befriended the world. If you don't have the world coming against you, make sure you have not befriended the world. Because your Bible says that you're in it but not of it. You're not to be a friend to the world. You're to share the greatest friend to the world. I understand it's not a popular message. I understand maybe you were wanting an uplifting message today, but Father told me to raise warriors, and I ask you today, are you a warrior today, church? I think we need to rededicate ourselves today. I think we need to rededicate this church today. Because what's happening, church, is we're not advancing the kingdom of God out into the streets. We're not advancing the kingdom of God out into those places. We're not advancing the kingdom of God in our tithes and offerings. You say, well, wait, oh, he's going to talk about money. Yeah, I'm going to talk about money. I'm not going to apologize for it. If you're not paying your tithes or offerings, you're robbing God. You're robbing God. If you're giving Him everything you have in a wallet, that's a good thing. Except if you had more in the bank and you didn't think about bringing anything to church. Are you hearing me today, church? That's the truth. Will you stand before God one day, the one who's called the healer and the provider, the bright and morning star, the Alpha, the Omega, will you stand before Him one day and say, sorry, God, I just didn't have the money, and He's going to show you all the money you did have. Are you going to do that, church? Are you going to stand Him before one day and say, you know what, I just didn't have the gift of evangelism, and He's going to show you all the gifts that He gave you in your life that you never walked in. See, we live our lives for today. I don't live my life for today. I live it for my eternity. I'm planning eternity. Some of you have life insurance policies. Guess what? We're all destined to die one day. And the life insurance policy will take care of those that are behind you. But I'm also thinking about the one I'm about to go answer to. Did I do everything I could? Did I pay my tithes? Did I pray? Did I witness? Did I testify? Did I cry every time I was persecuted for His name's sake when I'm supposed to rejoice? Come on. We're going to rededicate ourselves today at this altar. And the worship team's up here because they're going to lead you in worship. But I want to leave you with an encouraging part. King Solomon, he created the temple. He rebuilt the temple. And something happened in 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 1. Let me just read that to you real quick. When he dedicated the temple, he said the following words. Then said Solomon, the Lord had said that he would dwell in the thick darkness. But I have built a house of habitation for thee. and a place for thy dwelling forever. And the king turned his face and blessed the whole congregation of Israel, and all of the congregation of Israel stood. Now I ask you a question. Is Living Word Church a habitation for the Lord? I think that's obvious because you feel him the second you walk in the door. The next question, are you a habitation for the Lord? If you are, would you stand to your feet? Now, many of you know on Friday night, I just stepped into an apostolic anointing. And in that anointing, it's a fresh anointing and it's a fresh authority. And I'm going to bless this house and I'm going to bless you, the partners, with this newfound authority that God has bestowed on me. And then I'm going to release the worship team to call down the fire. I said, I'm going to release the worship team to call down the fire. Hallelujah. And I'm going to tell you why that is so important. Because in the very next chapter, after King Solomon prayed the dedication and prayed the prayer that I'm about to pray over you, it says this, chapter 7, verse 1. And when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the house of the Lord filled the house. And the priests could not even enter into the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. And when all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and how the glory of the Lord was upon the house, they bowed themselves with their faces to the ground upon the pavement. And they worshiped and they praised the Lord, saying, for he is good and his mercy endureth forever.
Amen.
Then the king and all the people offered sacrifices before the Lord. Listen to what King Solomon did. Verse 5. And King Solomon offered a sacrifice of 22 oxen and 120,000 sheep, so that the king and all the people dedicated the house unto the Lord. Why did I read verse 5? Because what you're about to do as I pray, what you're about to do needs to be your best, or don't even bother. What you're about to do, if you truly want God to come into you, if you truly want to be a habitation of God, if you just truly want to walk the Christian walk and have peace that surpasses all understanding, no matter what you're going through, then right now you've got to sacrifice the oxen. You've got to sacrifice the sheep with your praise and with your worship. I think we need some carpet time today. I think we need to carry him more in everything we do. I think we really need to stop focusing on ourselves and focus on him. And I think that's how Living Word Church will go to the next level of advancing his kingdom. Because we'll no longer be looking at ourselves and all the things we're going through. We'll find our place in that military line. We'll find our place in his army. We'll find that spot that he's reserved since before the creation of the earth. And we'll step into our destiny. Come hell, come high water, come persecution, come shame, come sickness and infirmity. We walk and we advance his kingdom. And we count it pure joy when we're attacked. It's so interesting. So many people in the American church today think that everything's got to be perfect or there's sin in the camp. I say if everything's perfect, there is definitely sin in your camp. That's just the truth. That's the word. That's not me being judgmental. I guarantee you, if you go through any of the New Testament, any book in the New Testament, you will find trials and tribulations. None of that is perfect. None of it. So let's stop looking at the perfect lives of others, wishing we were there. Because one day you're gonna say, thank you, Lord, I never walked in those shoes. I guarantee you. Matthew, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we speak in other tongues? Didn't we do all these things for you? And he says, get away from me. I never knew you. It's not my word. It's his. What would happen, church, if you and I learned to rejoice in trials and tribulations? Oh, that's giving the devil credit. No, I'm telling the devil, even when you put this on me, I still will praise my Lord and Savior. That's what I'm saying. And just like I said earlier, and I'll close with this, and I'm going to pray after this. Oh, Lord. He's never failed me. And I'm so thankful for that. We wouldn't be here after 10 years. We wouldn't be here after a year if he had ever failed me. Have I had my dark times? Absolutely. Have I had my hard times? Absolutely. I'm going through it now. But I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to rejoice. Because he's never failed me before. What makes me think he's going to start now? My Father is faithful and true. Is your Father faithful and true? Would you raise your hands? Would you receive this blessing? Father, we come before you, Lord, and we are grateful to you, God. We are grateful for you are the King of the universe. You are the creator of all things, Lord. Our hairs are numbered on our head. Not a day goes by where you don't know where we're at or what we're going through or what's coming, Lord. But you're still faithful and true, Father, for we know that you are the creator, the king of the universe. All things answer to you, O God. And we make you king over this church and king over the partners of this church. Holy Spirit, we're so grateful for you. We ask, Holy Spirit, that you would move among the partners, the friends, the visitors, Lord. That you would move on our hearts, that we would listen to you even with the noisiness of life. Yes. That we would carry you everywhere we go and we would release you in every home we visit, in every place that we walk into. Father, that the Holy Spirit would break out at Walmart and HEB. That we would truly carry you into our homes, that we would just speak peace into the home, the doorsteps, as we've been taught. Holy Spirit, we're grateful for what you've done, but we're asking for more. My Jesus, my sweet Jesus, we are so grateful to you. For you hung on that cross for my sins. You took what I deserve and you paid the price. My Lord, my God, your hands were pierced in the place of our own. Your feet and side were pierced in the place of our own. They shamed you. They beat you in the place of us. And at any moment, sweet Jesus, you could have pulled yourself off the cross and said, you guys ain't worth it. But you endured. You endured. You endured. We're so grateful, Lord. We're so grateful. Father, we're grateful for our partners that make sacrifices, Lord, that walk in faith, that says, I'm paying my tithes not knowing if I'll have enough to pay my bills, that are giving offerings above the tithes to meet the needs of the church, that come faithfully on Thursdays and Fridays and Sundays, Lord. Father, I dedicate them unto you right now in the name of Jesus. Fill them up with expectation. Fill them up, O God, with the spirit of revival. I release that spirit of revival now in the name of Jesus, that the partners of this church would advance your kingdom everywhere they set their foot.
Amen.
And Father, we're grateful for the friends of the ministry. We're grateful for I Am Church. We're grateful for those that have partnered with us. Pastor Fraz in Pakistan, Andrew Peters, Brother Ray, those that have partnered with us, believing in the ministry, knowing, recognizing that the foundation of this church over 10 years has been built long and wide. It's time for the walls to go up, Lord. It's time for the walls to go up. Father, we rededicate Living Word Church to you right now. We ask that you restore any fire that's been lost. We ask that you would just cause this church not to have a church service, but to have a worship service, one in which we come in worshiping you above our problems, above our situations, above all other things, God, that we would worship you, Lord. That we would raise up holy hands, God, that we would lift up our voices.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The Lord says, straighten your backs. Stop slouching. Stop walking in defeat. For you, the partners of this church, will be the walls of this church that I am building. Straighten your backs. Lift up your heads. Watch the glory, my glory, come into this house. Take your place in this house. For a wall cannot be built with a hole in it, the Lord says. And I will give you the strength to hold up the part that I have called out for you, the Lord says. You will not only have the strength to hold up the wall, the Lord says, but I will adorn you with banners and shofars and trumpets for your praises shall usher in my presence. Straighten your backs. Lift up your heads. For even if the world were to end today, I would gather you unto myself, the Lord says. So you have nothing to fear. You have nothing to fear. The world fears, for they do not know me. But you, my sons and daughters, have nothing to fear. For I will not allow harm to come upon you. For you are my son, you are my daughter. And you bring great joy to me, the Lord says. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord has just shown me a vision in which you were straight as soldiers. And you were the 2x4s of the walls. And those of you that are worshipers, those of you that are praisers, you weren't just part of the wall. I saw you standing there with shofars and with trumpets and with banners. As you held up your part of the wall, the Lord showed me that you were to worship him. You were to glorify him. You were to open your mouths and to praise him. And that you were going to usher in just as he rode in on that donkey on Jerusalem that day. Because all of you were in the walls, were just facing each other, and you were rolling out the red carpet for the king. Hallelujah. I want to invite you right now. Do not let this word pass you by. Do not allow this word to just say, okay, well, yeah, he gave it to us, and walk out and go to the fellowship. Do not let this word pass you by, for I truly believe that God is getting ready to advance Living Word Church. And he can give you everything you need right now. Now, you can do this in your seat. You can do this in your row. You can do this in your at the altar. Whatever you do, just make sure you do it, okay? Listen to what I'm about to say. Your lack has been because you will not advance his kingdom. Your lack is because you will not advance his kingdom. I don't lack financially. I'm not talking just financially, guys. How do I advance his kingdom? Everywhere you go, you let loose that Holy Ghost. Everywhere you go, you let loose that Holy Ghost. Well, I don't know. I don't feel him. He's there. He's there. Just let him out. Let him out. That's all you got to do. Let him out. He speaks to people through you. You're the vessel, church. You're the vessel. Every single one of you. I don't care how new a Christian you are. I don't care how old a Christian you are. Quite honestly, us older Christians, we get a little dry and flaky and broken down because we don't have the freshness and the oil of when we first got saved. That joy, that unspeakable joy. Would you join the worship team? Would you join me right now? Would you just start to just seek him for a little bit? Seek him right now. If you got to get on your face, get on your face. If you want to sit down, sit down. We're not going to tell you how to do it, but we're going to tell you, please, for your sake, do it. Just seek him. I don't know how. It's easy. Call on the name of the Lord. He says, all those that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
Just call on him. We don't go by feeling. We go by faith. We don't go by physical manifestations. Signs and wonders are supposed to follow us, not lead us. They follow us. The signs and wonders are for others, they're not for you. If you're bringing the signs and wonders, they're not for you. It doesn't confirm your ministry, church. Because they follow you. They don't lead you. Don't look for those things. Don't go after those things from meeting to meeting. He's inside you. Let him out. Hallelujah.
This is definitely confirmed. Father says, if you will make this a very special moment for him, but to allow the worship team to lead you into his presence, into a deep part of his presence. And Father also said, he said, when there are many, there's strength. When there's many with me, it's unstoppable. So we ask for your trust, and the worship team, Mario, Amanda, Johnny Lover, Judy, Ariel, Jonathan, and myself, I say in the name of Jesus that we intercede for those that may be having trouble, that as a team, we will intercede for you. And Father says to start off with repentance. And repentance is very simple. It just means change your mind. Change your mind. Change your mind. We have the mind of Christ. It can be done in an instant. You can repent in a half a second. Change your mind to Jesus. Change your mind to heaven. Change your mind to things above. And say, Father, it's all for you. And that's repentance. And the last thing that he told me was, he says, sing from your hearts. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. He says, start with your hearts. Sing to him a song from your heart. And you'll go to a place that's awesome.
Continue to call out with this song. We thank you for your word, Lord. And we pray, just as your word says in James, that we would not just be hearers of your word, but we would be doers of your word. We call out to you, oh Lord. Hear our cry. We hunger for your anointing on our lives. We call out to you. Spirit, fill
with your power. Descend upon us this hour. We need your spirit. Fill our hearts with your power. Descend upon us this hour. We need your spirit. To you, oh Lord, hear our cry. We hunger for your anointing on our lives. Call out to you, oh Lord, hear our cry. We call out for your anointing on our lives. Descend upon us this hour. We need your spirit. Fill our hearts with your power. Descend upon us this hour. We need your spirit. Your power descend upon us this hour. We need your spirit,
calling out to you, Almighty God.
Fill our hearts, Lord.
Fill our hearts, Lord.
We need your spirit. Spirit, fill our hearts with your power. descend upon us this hour. We need your Spirit. Fill our hearts with your power. Descend upon us this hour. We need, more and more and more and more of you, God. Fill us up, oh God. Fill us up, oh God. We need, want more and more and more and more of you, God. Fill us up, oh God.
When you're in the presence, your problems don't mean as much anymore. Suddenly, the problems aren't as big as they look like. Because when you're not in the presence, your problems look like mountains. But when you're in the presence, you cast the mountains into the sea. You cannot live and walk the Christian walk without His presence. Otherwise, you're going to fall away, church. And I tell you because I love you. I tell you because it's truth. Don't let your problems define you. You are a son. You are a daughter of the Most High God. And for every mountain, the enemy rises up against you. He said, if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, you can cast that mountain into the sea. I think we need to start casting some mountains into the sea. I think we need to start advancing the kingdom for His glory. For His glory is our glory. We stop living the day we said, Jesus, come into my life. Come into my heart. Save me. Be Lord. Be King. Be my everything. Amen. Hallelujah. A couple things real quick. You can walk into the fellowship with His presence. Don't change the switch. You can walk, practice, be good practice for walking into work like this. Walking into school. You can walk into the fellowship carrying His presence. Amen. The other thing is, Thursday night, we'll be teaching about our identities, but the worship team's only going to go for about 30, 40 minutes because we're going to try to end at 8:30. For those of you that are being trained in the prophetic, I want to train you Thursday night at 8:30 and then Friday night at 8:30 as well, because we've got just a couple of weeks, okay? That gives me four more times to pour into you. And then also, we may get together one more time before that Friday, okay? Guys, if you're praying right now, you need to pray for Prophetic Fridays, because God has shown me great things. Great things. Which means there'll be mountains in the way. But my Bible says that those things that are high, He brings low. And those things that are low, He brings straight. Amen? So whatever comes in the way, I'm ready for it, because Prophetic Friday starts August 1st. And we need to pray, and we need to push, and we need to start promoting that. So this Thursday. Now, Father, right now we ask that You bless the food. Bless the worship that was given to You. We bless You, King of the universe. All for Your glory, God. Now teach us to walk over to the other side and to carry what we're walking in right now. Let us not turn the switch off, Father. In fact, remove the switch from our lives, that we always walk in Your presence. Hallelujah. Shall we advance, church?
Amen.
Shall we advance? Not this Thursday. Is it this Thursday? Oh, I do have... Okay. Oh, wonderful. Okay, we have Alice and Pete Garza this Thursday. So prophetic team, yeah, that's a good time. Prophetic team, we'll have to do it Friday, okay? It's going to be a good time. You don't want to miss it. Alice and Pete Garza from Radio Our Jesus will be here this Thursday, all right? Thank you, my love. Always checking my back. Always... Oh, okay. All right. Thank you, Mom. Thank you, wife. Well, let's go have some fellowship. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah?
We want to end on a high note. You know that? We want to celebrate. So feel free to walk out or stay or whatever you want to do. So,
see, this is like a graduation party, because we're not who we were when we walked in. Something happened here today, just as Pastor mentioned. So I feel a need to celebrate. How about you? We're gonna praise His name, 'cause He is worthy. Thank You, Jesus. What? Come on, let's sing it together. Here we go.
All around, all around. Everywhere I look, Your love is all around. All around, all around. Everywhere I look, Your love is all around.
One more time.
All around, all around. Everywhere
work, your love is all around.
Celebrate! Come on, let the nation sing. Here we go.
Let the nation sing. Let the people shout. Let your kingdom come. Pour your spirit out.
Manifest your love.
Manifest. Manifest your love. Manifest. Manifest your love.
All together.
All around. All around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. All around. All around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
One more time.
All around. All around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
Let the nation sing.
Let the nation sing. Let the people shout. Let your kingdom come, pour your spirit out. Manifest, manifest your love. Manifest, manifest your love.
All around,
all around, all around. Everywhere your love is all around, all around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
Hallelujah! Let's celebrate His love, church.
Church was born.